right? And let me tell you, Bhavna, that at SIT also we try to maintain all these things, and we try to, you know, in the since from the beginning of recruiting of the students for PAT program till the final defense happens, we make it point it should be systematic. At every stage, all my scholars should get that support and benefit that they should have in terms of, you know, kind of a mental support or a financial support or infrastructural support and so on. So I think if at all you get all this thing at place, then you can also be a equally competent researcher as that of IITs. And that will definitely reflect out of your research works in terms of publication, patents, and any sort of innovation. So you will be, you know, considered equally as a IIT research. So there won't be, once your research starts speaking about you, there won't be any question like from where you did the PhD, right? So I suggest you that you don't just bother about the place where you are doing PhD. You just focus and try to give best out of yours, so that there should not be any ambiguity in your mind in the future. Okay, Bhavna?
Thank you very much.
Right. So today, Dr. Satish has allocated me 2 hours for, you know, introducing yourself, you people, for a research introduction. Or introduction to research, and you know, I know this particular topic is being chewed by you from long. During your MTech also, you got the subject called research methodology. Now there are various sessions happened during your induction program, wherein you are being, you know, guided for this particular topic. So many times it becomes very difficult for us to go, you know, literally by the points mentioned in the book about research methodology. Or about introduction to research, and many times it becomes very monotonous for the students to listen same and same thing, you know, in terms of research methodology. Second interesting fact about this particular topic is that it seems to be very easy when we read the topic of this research methodology. It seems very, you know, genuine and very logical that yes, whatever the given in the book is very true, and I understood that. The points mentioned in the books are really simple. Everybody can easily understand that particular point. But when it comes to literally implement these things in your own work, or for the sake, if at all you are having this as a one of the subject in your induction program or in your coursework, and at the end of this coursework, when you will be facing examination for research methodology, and when time comes to, you know, reproduce whatever you understood about research methodology on your answer sheet, then it becomes very difficult to reproduce the same thing, right? So why it is? Because we are not grabbing the points mentioned in the books in the literal sense of related to our own work, right? And I thought it's better that if you could understood all these points mentioned in the research methodology in terms of your own project, or in terms of, you know, any of the sample project you can consider throughout this topic, right? So this time I thought I'm also, you know, teaching this subject to my MTech students, present batch of MTech CAD/CAM, as I'm, you know, associated with mechanical engineering department. I am teaching this research methodology to my MTech mechanical students. So there I adopted a methodology wherein I consider any one of the problem statement, and in consultation with that particular problem statement, I try explaining them these different aspects of research methodology to them, so that when we talk in terms of, you know, any of the case study, you understood it thoroughly, and not in the exact way it is given in the book. But in some of the other way, you can definitely represent all these points when it comes to reproduce the things in the examination. So in today's session for 2 hours, and maybe next Friday, I have been also given a 2 hours for the same topic. So I will try to explain you this particular topic, or try to introduce you with research in 4 hours, right? I think it is best choice to select a person who already did their PhD to introduce to the research. And when it comes to, you know, how can I introduce you with, you know, the topic selected by you? So it's not like I'm going to tell you something how to do research in your area specifically, because somebody from you maybe from mechanical, from electronics telecommunication, from computer science and IT, or maybe civil engineering. So it becomes very difficult for me to exactly guide you how to go about the research in your own area. But in general terms, being already done my PhD, I can definitely make you aware about the, you know, ups and downs of this particular process. Because it's a long-term process, you know, you enroll for the PhD and, you know, it's almost a, you know, work of 3 to 4 years. Sometimes it's also extended up to 5 years, right? So it's a long-term goal for your life. And before going along with this, you should aware about these ups and downs of this particular process, right? Then it becomes very smooth travel through this particular path. So I will share the presentation with you. And as I rightly mentioned, in the very first slide, so everybody can see the presentation slides now?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
So our next slide is very, a memorable thing for you. Somebody may laugh on this, and somebody will say that's a very funny picture sir is producing here. But this is a fact. You are at a stage wherein this boy is literally at present, and this must be your happiest moment of your life, that you started telling people that yes, you are enrolled for the PhD. But a real thing comes next, right? And I will suggest that it's not for, you know, threatening you, but it's like making you aware that during this next 4 or 5 years, this could be the situation. You may, as in the last session, even Kotecha sir also mentioned you that if it is not being done systematically and considering all aspects of this process, many people quit the PhD in between, right? Because they have not planned it systematically, or they are not aware about this ups and downs beforehand. So there may be a situation in these 4 years that you may feel, it's what I am doing, I don't know. What my guide is telling to me, I don't know. Where we are heading exactly, we don't know. No, you know, it's like, you know, my guide is just harassing me or punishing me, right? But your guide will exactly know where you are and what direction you required, what kind of treatment you required to, you know, make you working in that particular aspect. So maybe in the beginning or first 2-3 years, you may get, you know, so much of trouble and, you know, tension and, you know, kind of frustration. But then you will realize that no, this was requirement for my work to begin with, and this is something very much needed at that moment. And now this is very, you know, common in this process. So I have to be, you know, ensured or making my mind ready that yes, this is going to happen with me, because this is something very different and I alone have to do this. So it is part and parcel of this process, and that thing you started realizing, and then your work become little bit smooth. You started focusing in this, and remember me, my words, the moment you start or stop telling others that you are doing PhD, the moment you get that patience in your mind that you don't, you know, immediately, you know, become vocal. The moment you start listening people carefully, the moment you start explaining the, you know, students, if at all you are from any of the teaching profession or in other way also, the moment you start explaining the people the logic behind the things and try to make them understand things, you confirm that you are on the verge of completing your PhD. Okay? So these are the, you can consider these as a symptoms, that, you know, you start developing patience, you start listening people. मैं हिंदी में बोलूँगा कि वो एक ठहराव आ जाता है आपकी ज़िंदगी में, कि आप अपने आप को शांत रखने लगते हैं, आप लोगों को सुनने लगते हैं, आप लोगों की बातें समझ के उनको एक्सप्लेन करने की कोशिश करते हैं, एंड ट्राई टू, यू नो, मेक यूर सेल्फ मोर डिसिप्लिन. एंड वेन वी स्टेज रीच, यू कन्फर्म दैट you are on the verge of finishing your research work. right? That's the beauty of this particular process, PhD one. Because I have gone through this, and many of my students also gone through this. So presently I'm guiding few students and they are also experiencing. And best way here is like in Symbiosis Institute of Technology, we always develop a culture that there is a very good and friendly atmosphere between students and the guides. And somehow students share their experiences, and based on that, I can confirm that whatever I'm saying will definitely be experienced by you in the future, right? So don't be afraid by this particular photograph, but try to keep this in your mind that this is going to happen. And it is always good that if at all you are prepared for the situation, you can face the situation more bravely and strongly, isn't it? So this is the beginning. So as I listened various two, three questions from you people in the last session, I thought ki, let us add one slide into my presentation. And in the 10 minutes break, I prepared this slide. And I thought you should be aware about these things. So when it comes to, you know, make your research more successful, or, you know, you should achieve heights in your research, what you required is mentioned in this slide, right? So are you people, those who joined to Symbiosis International University for PhD program, and so are you aware that you are going to get the exposures of different type of research project happening in the organization? You will surprise that in SIT, almost 3 to 4 crore rupees of research project at presently going on. The research projects from various funding agencies like DST, VIRAC, and so many things, right? So if at all you decide, you will get the exposure, but you have to take that initiative that yes, which project is going on where. That you have to identify, you have to start interacting with the people, you have to start interacting with the guides, researcher, and then you will definitely come to know, right? And unless you explore this thing, now you won't come to know, you won't getting exposure to the various topics of research, right? Many of you must have, you know, defined their problem statement, you know, for submitting to the CIRI during interview process. So I want you, all of you, by the time I explain all these things to you, you take a pen and paper and you just note down whatever the problem statement you defined for your interview process, right? During your selection process, whatever synopsis you have submitted, you be ready with your problem statement, because in the due course of this presentation, we are going to utilize that statement, and in coordination with that statement, I am going to explain you the different topic I am going to introduce with the research process as such, right? So that was one thing. So very first point was like exposure with research project in the organization. So be proactive, start interacting with the people, those who are already on the funded projects. Best example, I think many of you must have attended various research conferences and might have even published a paper in the conferences. Can anybody tell me why we encourage to publish in the conference? Right? I feel that for you people, those who are doing PhD, publishing the paper in the conference is much better than publishing it in a journal. What is your comment on this? Anyone?
Collaboration, possible collaboration.
Okay, got okay. It.
Because of sir, that we can know how what is the recent works in our area of field,
right?
So we can meet people who are working in the same area, and a lot of networking can happen,
right?
Eminent speaker programs.
Exactly.
That will help us to.
Very true. Very true. Right.
Sir, so we get instant reaction on our views.
Okay, that is also true. So these are the few points I think rightly explained by you people, and most of you are very aware about this thing, that conferences are always organized based on the current trends in the technology, right? Always there is a theme. Many times it is fine that though the conferences, the name is quite common and it's very generic, that recent trends in technology or recent trends in electronics and telecommunication, recent trends in mechanical engineering. But organizers make it point that the topic covered under this organization are a very recent one, and the subtopics clearly define the area in which recent developments are happening. So in the literal sense, when you are submitting your paper, that is one way. But when you are attending these conferences, you are going to meet the people in the same area, those who are already working in the area wherein you have put your paper. There may be many people who are already joined there to publish or present their papers. So it is a place wherein you can interact with the people who are doing the work in the same area. So I always insist my student that whenever you attend any of the conference, you start interacting with the people there. Many times I could find that those who submitted the paper in the conferences just reached to the venue when there is a presentation organized. Suppose your presentation is organized at 12 o'clock, then people just, you know, think of reaching that place at 11:30, and they just make that organizer hurry, like, put my presentation immediately. They present the paper and then they think, my work is now done. And they immediately left the venue. So don't do that. You know, whenever you are attending any of the conferences for 2 days, spend your maximum time there, interact with the people there, so that you will come to know what they are doing, what different they are doing in their research area. And that gives you much more insightfulness than reading any of the research paper. Because whenever we refer any of the research paper, our tendency is to just read the introduction and the conclusion. Most of you will do this, because I have also done that, right? And that will not give you the insight, like how exactly that particular work is being carried out. But when you interact with the people, you can understand many things from him or her whenever you interact with them. So attending the conferences is must in this phase of your PhD work. And in a year, at least try to attend minimum 2 to 3 conferences. And most on that, try interacting with the people during conferences. Now that there is not a situation, because nowadays whatever conferences are happening online, you could see that, you know, even you don't able to see the face of the people, right, attending the conference, forget about the interaction. So this phase will definitely go out, and then soon there will be a phase that you will start attending the conference physically and start interacting with people. So that time, do remember that interaction with the people during conferences is must, right? So here also in SIT, I suggest you to, before you, if at all you have not finalized your research statement, even with guide, then first interact with the various guides and whatever the projects they are doing here, just try to understand them. And that's the beauty here, that there are so many research projects presently going on, which are funded research projects, right? From the central funding agency, international funding agency, and so on. Second thing is the infrastructural facility. You are fortunate that at SIT you got lot of infrastructure. Most of the recent technology related infrastructure is available at SIT. And if not, then you will get chance to collaborate with the organization wherein that facility is available, right? Do you know that at SIT, under SCRE, we have 5 research centers. One of the research center is SKY, that is headed by Director Kotecha sir, and Symbiosis Center for Applied Artificial Intelligence, that we call as SKY. Likewise, there are 4 more. Now your job is to understand which are these other 4 research centers available in SIT. I hope during this induction program, you will try to explore that which are the research centers available at SIT. That is kind of homework given to you, right? So how this research center help us? Because they have dedicated staff which are working on the funded research project. Each research center has got their head, research center head, and under that head there are minimum 5 to 6 faculties working as a full-time researcher. Mind you, they are not a regular faculty of SIT. They are exclusively recruited as a researcher in the centers. Okay. Under them, there are many PhD students. Under PhD student, there are even M.Tech students doing research there, right? And there are so many incumbents joined to the research center. every year they draw the advertisement, they ask student to join their research center with their idea. So it's a fantastic, you know, collaboration and kind of facility available at SIT. So try to explore it. Fourth point is funding. What mostly required during PhD is like a financial support. I know most of you are doing this by doing your own job, right? Most of you are, though there are full-time researcher, but many times it becomes very difficult to manage everything, right? That home affairs and office affairs and in this that PhD program. And when it comes to a kind of a lump sum amount required for this research program, from where to get it, right? And though we have various government and international funding agency, many times we don't have that, you know, experience how exactly to apply and grab the funding, right? And even we don't even bear that confidence that whether we could get it or not, because the number of people applying for this funding is very high, right? Now, surprisingly, you understand that SIRI is providing you a funding here, right? You might have got this insight during your induction program that there is two types of funding available. One is a major funding and another is a minor funding. So major funding is up to 10 lakh rupees and minor funding is up to 1.5 lakh rupees. Now, from your guide, you try to understand how can you grab this. You need not to be a, you know, direct applicant, but if at all you have decided to work on particular topic, your guide can definitely apply for this funding based on the same topic. Okay. And once that funding is sanctioned, that amount will be utilized for the exact work you are doing. You can purchase equipment through this funding, you can purchase materials, you can purchase consumables, you can purchase books, you can, get the membership of any professional databases and so many things. And you can definitely utilize this funding. And, you know, this in case of minor is 1.5 lakh rupees, but in case of major, it's up to 10 lakh rupees. It's a huge funding, right? Anybody who is determined to work hard and has very high enthusiasm to, you know, develop something, innovate something or utilize latest of the machine tools. So this type of funding will definitely help. But you have to go very systematically. You have to approach your guide. You have to understand how exactly this funding can be grabbed according to the right of proposal, apply to SIU, grab the funding, and then start working on that project, right? So like IIT, there is a provision of getting this funding. So don't miss this, right? You will have very excellent output at the end of the research work if at all you could grab these fundings, okay? International collaboration, again, as I mentioned you that you have directors are also mentioning you that even a research scholar who was doing, you know, PhD here, if at all, recently two of the research scholar who was working under a guide and who has got the funding from the outside agency, and in that funding there was a provision of traveling abroad for publication to attend conferences. Two of the research scholars already visited Australia, UK and America to present their papers through the funding received by the guide, right? And at here at SIT, we don't have any restriction that once the paper is selected, whether to guide go there or to student go there, right? It's just like IITs. In IITs also the same thing happen. Guide, you know, get the funding, they combinedly publish a paper, and when it comes to present that paper in international conference, that PhD student only go and present the paper. What is the intention? To give him maximum exposure of international research scholar. When that particular PhD scholar go and present the paper there at any of the international venue, he met several researchers in the same area. He can interact with them, he can understand what exactly new going on, and then he can share it with his guide. So that's very beneficial. So you should also plan these things, right? Patent, if you are not aware, then I think Dr. Amit has already had this session with you during induction program. So try to take maximum benefit out of it, because SIU is going to fund a complete amount whatever required to get sanction of your patent. Not only publication, but granting of the patent also, right? So don't miss this opportunity. because this type of facility hardly available in any of the research organization. That research organization is only spending on your patent expenses. Right? Also, we have innovation incubators facility here. That if at all you have any innovative idea, you can pursue that idea beginning with the designing to the launching of that particular product in the market. We are helping you in terms of making the design, prototype, identifying the companies for launching that particular product in the market, and even to produce first prototype and help you to understand how exactly that product will look alike, right? So even we are providing some funding from MHRD ministry to launch our own product, to launch our own startup. So this facility is itself available in SIT on third floor. Try and go explore this particular facility. That if at all you have any of the innovative idea in your mind, how to pursue that idea with the help of these centers, right? Then we have publication support. We are helping you, Siri will help you in terms of not even from drafting and editing the papers, even for sometimes funding the fees of any of the international journal. If at all these journals are Q1 or Q2 journals, right? So your guide can definitely get the funding in terms of the payment of the fees of the journal, if at all it's a Q1 rank journal, right? So many facilities are available here. It's up to you how you are going to grab these facilities. Is this clear? So I thought, based on your question in the last session, I thought let me make you aware about these facilities so that you will feel more proud and comfortable and confident that yes, everything which is required to do good research is available at SIT, and it's up to me that how I am going to grab these all facilities. Okay, so do take advantage of these things and try to make your research work more fruitful and efficient. So that was the beginning from my side. Actually, my today's topic is the introduction to research, and I earlier thought of making you aware about definition of research. There are so many definitions available, but I want to keep this thing remember throughout, that research is nothing but it's a systematized effort to gain a new knowledge. That's it. So always remember that you have to gain knowledge, and that for that purpose only you have enrolled here for the PhD program. And in the literary sense, if you want to understand what you mean by research, then it's a research in the process of finding solution to the problem after thorough study and analysis of situational factors, right? So this is a technical definition. But what you should remember, that you are here to gain more knowledge. That's it. Whatever difficulty comes in your way, you will going to take over of it and try to get more and more knowledge. Now, in the beginning only, I ask you to be ready with your problem statement so that we can discuss this particular topic in terms of your own problem statement. So I hope you noted down the problem statement submitted in a synopsis report submitted to Siri before your interview process. Okay, so before we move to the next task for you, let me briefly know whatever the problem statement you noted down on the paper, they must be falling under any of this type, right? So there are in terms of the objective of research, you could see that they can be categorized into four main types. One thing is we call it as a exploratory or formulative research, wherein to gain familiarity with a phenomenon or to achieve new insights into it, right? So a best example of this could be given as suppose there is a second law of thermodynamics, right? And you know the second law of thermodynamics thoroughly, and now based on that law you want to develop some phenomena, right, to achieve something. If you are doing that type of research work, if your problem statement is oriented like that based on any of the theory or theorem you want to achieve something, that will comes under the type called exploratory or formulative research, right? Next research could be a descriptive research. What it says? To portray accurately the characteristics of particular individual, situation or group, right? Best example is like, suppose you are a designer, you want to launch a new type of jacket in the market, right? You are into fashion industry. Now you want to understand which type of jacket is suitable in which areas, right? You could find nowadays that there are many jackets in which are mostly meant for very low temperature areas, like, you know, wherein there is an actual snowfall is there, but still people are using in our areas also, right? So it becomes very difficult to understand people's strength, right, and people's liking. So whenever you are doing research of that type, that you want to accurately identify the characteristics of individual person or a situation or a group, then that type of research can be termed in terms of the descriptive research. So while I'm explaining this to you, I want you to understand whatever the problem statement you have submitted, that in which category your problem statement is falling, right? So we keep that going on behind your mind, that you know, out of these four types, where my problem statement is exactly falling. Sorry. Third is to determine the frequency with which something occurs or which it is associated with something else, right? Best example can be given, recent example of coronavirus, right? You can you know, getting the statistics every day, how many people infected, how many of them are recovered, how many are active, how many are home quarantine, and so many things. And mostly nowadays you are just focusing on the frequency, right? अरे नंबर कम हो रहा है, अरे नंबर बढ़ रहा है, अरे नंबर अगर एक वीक तक ऐसा रहा तो अच्छा हो जाएगा, राइट? सो मेनी थिंग. सो दिस टाइप ऑफ रिसर्च कम्स अंडर द रिसर्च कॉल्ड डायग्नोस्टिक रिसर्च. एंड फोर्थ वन इज द हाइपोथेसिस. सो यू नो बेटर अबाउट द हाइपोथेसिस, हाउ टू डिफाइन अ हाइपोथेसिस एंड हाउ टू मेक दैट हाइपोथेसिस नल वाइड और एक्यूरेट हाइपोथेसिस, राइट? सो दिस आर द मेन ऑब्जेक्टिव ऑफ डूइंग योर रिसर्च. That either you try to explore something, or you try to describe some descriptive something, or you try to diagnose something, or you try to have a plain hypothesis defined for your research statement. Okay, so I want you all to identify under which category your problem statement is falling. I am trying to define that here. So anyone who is thinking that their problem statement is falling under the category of exploration, okay, can tell me that statement. I will just write down here, and then we can, if at all it's not that category, then we can definitely discuss here, right? So it will be a small exercise for you to make it confirm that which type of problem can be called as the exploration, which can be called as the describe, diagnose, hypothesis, induction and deduction, right? This is something additional I have mentioned here that I will explain. Like many times it happen that you are, or suppose you are working in any of the automobile industry, right? Maybe ARAI or that sort of industry. You are doing a core research, suppose in the diesel engine, right? So I hope everybody is aware about IC engines, or you know, the way the IC engines are constructed. So it has got its typical you know, construction. There is a cylinder, and that cylinder is moving inside the piston. That piston is moving inside the cylinder, and mostly the piston, there are some rings on the piston which you know, help in, you know, efficiently compressing the gas, and you know, making it sure that after expansion the gases are not leaked, and it is successfully applying the force on the piston to move up and down, right? So many times what researchers do is they just add on something into that particular construction. Suppose there are 1 mm or 2 mm rings mounted on the piston, they either just change the size of that ring, or they just add one more ring so that the efficiency of the functioning of the engine is increasing, right? It seems to be very small change in the engine, but that going to, you know, affect in so many ways in terms of the efficiency and functioning of the engine, that it can completely change of the scenario of IC engine itself, right? You must be knowing that nowadays there are more mileage cars are coming in the market. Earlier it is, the mileage was very less, 8 kilometers per liter, 10 kilometers per liters, but you can see that there are more mileage car. So I am not saying that this is the factor exactly affecting on the mileage, but sometimes it happens that small induction or reduction out of the design, exact design, can make a more impact in your research work, right? Or make a more impact on the output of the functioning of something, right? And that should be considered as one of the research, right? So that's why that fifth topic I introduced here, that induction or deduction. So I want from you that how many of think or who think that their research, whatever the problem statement they defined in the synopsis, is falling under the area of exploration. Anyone? I'm throwing it to all. Anyone can mention, I can just type here.
Sir.
Yeah.
New ways to generate energy. Renewable energy.
Achha, remote renewable. Right? So non-conventional source of energy, suppose, right?
Yes, sir.
Right. So what kind of exploration can be done here? What I understood is there are fixed ways of doing the, you know, generating the energy, right? They are very well known. Even in terms conventional source, you know, right? The heat, yes, water, yes. And non-conventional also you understood now. That is solar, wind power, or maybe nuclear energy. What else exploration can be done?
Sir, maybe combination of multiple renewable energy sources.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yes. Any other example?
Then a change in material.
Right.
Then place of application.
Okay. Application for use or generation?
For use.
But then it won't comes under the identifying the source of renewable energy or generate the renewable energy. Application will be a completely different aspect together, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So yes, this could be one of the topic which can fall under the category of exploration. That's very right. Nowadays, people have started generating energy using the what we can say. They are putting that wind turbines kind of stuff on the divider of the roads, wherein there are very small wind turbines, right? We know turbines only in the larger form, right? But there are very small turbines, and these are just acting like a small flowers mounted on the plant. There is a plant on the divider of the road, and on that plant there are small turbine which will even, you know, move fast just because some vehicle is passing nearby and generate the energy, right? That way you saying this?
Maybe. Right now, because yet it is not finally decided with my teacher.
Right, I know. I just try to portray some example that people can understand that yes, it's exploration. Definitely. It's an innovative thing. Yeah. Anybody who can say that their project topic is falling under the described thing? I given you the example of fashion industries, right? Launching a new apparel, considering the likings and the of the people, or understanding the characteristics of the particular individual or group or region. So in that way, do anybody think that their research is falling under this category? Any example? Anyone? I want this interaction, you know, this session to be more interactive. I know you must be busy in some of the work at home also, but just focus on these topics presently.
Hello, sir. This is Rucha.
Okay.
I'm not sure that whether this topic is under describe or not, but
doesn't matter. We are just discussing here, right? Yes. We are trying to just exploring the things.
Yes. Okay. So my title is Blockchain Implemented Vending Machine. Blockchain implemented vending machine for regulating subsidized food distribution.
Anybody thinks that it is not a describable project or may not fall under this category? Or what percent is it can fall under this describe category? Or what makes it fall under the category of describe? Anyone? What's your good name, ma'am?
Rucha, sir.
Rucha.
Rucha.
Yeah.
Yes.
So at least can you a little bit elaborate on this? Why you think that this comes under the describe category?
Because it's a kind of product. Which we will be designing based on the demand of customers or based on the demand of
your main focus will be on
see in this we will it means I have published a patent also on the same topic. It is related with the public distribution system of India. It means distributing the rations and all those things.
Okay.
So normally what happens in that, there is a lack of what we can say, the security or there are a lot of
utilization also.
Utilization Look, and many frauds are also happening. Many frauds are also happening in the same thing. So just to avoid all those frauds, I was supposed to design this kind of machine so that we can exactly weight the amount of food which we want to distribute. And again, we are maintaining all those records in the blockchain so that we will be getting the tamper-proof records.
Exactly. Look, I am too convinced that your topic is going to fall under this. So at my level, at my understanding, I will try to explain them to all along with you. If at all you think that what I am thinking is can be a little bit changed, then we can definitely discuss upon this. But in your I am agreed to this first thing, that this falls under the category of describe. And from me, the reason is because your word in your problem statement here is a distribution, right? When it comes to distribute, that you have to think about masses, right? You are concerned about the masses, right? That you want to successfully distribute this, isn't it? Then that distribution required to understand where you want to distribute, right? So for that, you have to identify the characteristics like key, where is the requirement of distribution, right? As I mentioned, in case of the apparel industry, is like if I want to launch any of the cloth or apparel in any of the area, so I have to first identify where I should launch this. Where are the buyers of this particular product or jacket, right? Then only I can launch that or distribute that particular jacket in that area. And when you say distribution, then it also requires to understand the geographic, demographic condition, or maybe liking, disliking of the people. The way people lifestyle is there, right? And all these things. Because when it comes to get the food from vending machine, there is a class of people who accept the food from the vending machine, isn't it? Not everyone will accept it. Suppose there are the people who are very, I will say they prefer cooking at the home only. And if you put a vending machine there, why will they take it from the vending machine, right? So even the demographic study is also important, where you think that people will prefer collecting the food from the vending machine, right? Then again, more critical analysis will come when you say the subsidized food, right? Those people who could not offer food at higher rate, we need to identify area wherein people like to get a subsidized food, isn't it? So there is basically a very strong combination here, wherein you trying to identify people who want subsidized food and they are also oriented toward getting the food through vending machine. It's very critical to analyze this, and that's why you are using this blockchain, right? And which will accurately give you analysis that how to identify areas wherein you can distribute a subsidized food through vending machine, right? So it obviously requires so much of analysis and understanding of geography, the people characteristics, their purchasing power, their state of purchasing, and so many things, isn't it? Your main, if at all your main focus is on designing of this machine, vending machine, then it might not fall under this particular category, right? But here I am considering that the machine is already available. You just want to distribute this or decide where you want to implement this particular vending machine, isn't it, Ruchi? Am I right?
Yes, sir. Basically, I'm thinking of the ration distribution shops, ration shops.
Yeah. I got it. So in my opinion, she is properly, categorized her research topic under the describe category, right? Anybody has got any doubt or comment on this? We can definitely discuss. Right. So two categories are finalized already. Anyone who thinks that their topic falls under the category of diagnose? I gave you an example of coronavirus, right? The statistics behind coronavirus nowadays you are following. See, anybody who has already submitted their synopsis has mention of such a things. Look, this clarification, this understanding of your topic is very important. This is going to decide next your literature review, your objective selection, your methodology, and so many things. If you don't have a clear understanding of under which category your topic is falling, then it will become very difficult for you to go along with. Okay. So it's willingness, but you should be proactive on all these things. In my next slides of presentation, I am mentioning that the problem statement definition is very, very important. I think it's the most important part of your research project that decides your journey in next 3 years. Okay, so anyone who thinks that their topic is falling under the third category, please come up. Be interactive, don't be shy. Otherwise, this section will be boring. It won't be, that interesting session. So anyone? I think we are not, making this session interactive. How many students are there presently? 35, 34 students are there. Ashwin, you want to say something?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Actually, you talk about like design activities. Mm-hmm. So I am just thinking like my project is related to that. So in which category it will be going to place?
Related to design of dye.
Not dye. Basically, it's related to design of like automotive component.
Mm-hmm. Okay. But look, if at all, there are two different things. One is designing a complete new die, or there may be any die available in your company and you want to modify that die. So there are two aspects. So let's clear me one thing, whether you want to design a completely a new die or you want to modify a die, existing die.
It's not new, but it's a modification of existing.
Right, right. Then newer topic will definitely fall under this category, right? Because if you at all you want to modify the design, which are the most important aspect you will study?
What kind of requirement, what kind of the actual uses of that and where it get fitted.
Yes, that is called a life, die life, right? Yes. For how many life, how many components that die is sustaining, right? How many components you are getting out of that die effectively, and from which component it start deteriorating the quality of the component producing out of the die, isn't it? So we call it in terms of the life of the die, isn't it?
Okay.
For other those who are not from the mechanical field, a die is something, you know, a kind of what we can say, a mold wherein we pour a melted material and we get a component out of it, right? A process is a little bit different, but we can definitely call it as a mold, right? So Ashwin, so your project will definitely fall under this, provided that you are having a good data about the existing die. Okay. Data in terms of the number of components earlier die was giving, under which operating condition that die was working, the temperature and the pressure and, you know, the lubricate in condition. So suppose it is giving 2 lakh, how many components presently it is giving?
Sorry, I didn't get you, sir.
How many components the existing die is giving to you?
Not yet decided, sir. Just is concept stage. So I have not done that study.
Okay. No problem. Fine. So you can mute, Ashwin, because your error noise is coming. So usually in such a cases, if at all any existing die in industries is giving 1 lakh component or 2 lakh components, and if you want to modify it to give 3 lakh components so as to increase production rate or, you know, profit of the organization, then your research will definitely go under this category called a diagnosis, right? So that means you are going to investigate the existing system in terms of design, right? How the different design aspects of particular die are going to affect on the production rate of the component. And if at all you are going to modify that elements of the die, then how it's going to benefit you in the future in terms of the number of products, right? So definitely your project is going to fall under this category. It can be considered as the example. So for others, those who are, you know, thinking about their own project, if they are investigating on particular parameters of existing system, right, and they want to modify some of the parameters so as to increase the efficiency, productivity of the things, then that type of project will definitely fall under the category of diagnosis. Okay. Now, you know, this many times it's not only the parameters directly associated with the product, right? Sometimes there are so many factors also associated with this. Right, like maybe a demographic factor, a natural factor, an atmospheric factor, anything. Right, sometimes it also we can also consider that if at all there is a new technology comes in, and if that use of that new technology going to affect the functioning of the existing system, and if you try to understand that how that new technology going to improve my system, if at all I am going to implement, then that type of project also fall under the category of diagnosis, right? I will quote an example here. Nowadays in computer science and computer science field, the new tool comes that is called machine learning, isn't it? Based on the artificial intelligence. So you can use this tool at any place, in any field, right? And many must be thinking to use this particular tool to improve the efficiency of the existing system. Right. So for that they have to understand how presently the system is working. Many times there is so much data available, so many factors are, you know, responsible to make that system work, that manually you cannot analyze all the factors. Now suddenly the this machine learning AI tool comes in. Now most of you must be thinking, array, we should use this tool so that it will increase the efficiency or give you exact diagnosis key how exactly can be done to improvise the system. So even if you working in that sort of project, right, that will fall under this particular category. Clear this? So my next slide will be on that only, that many of you. But before that, now let us see ki, who think that their problem statements fall under the category of hypothesis.
So
yes.
So my topic is artificial intelligence on edge computing devices for fault analysis in industrial rotating machines.
Artificial intelligence on edge?
On edge computing devices for fault analysis in industrial rotating machines. So for diagnosis, I was telling you this.
Achha, you are telling it as a diagnosis? Okay.
Yeah.
Finish it and then I will put it there. AI on edge computing devices for fault analysis on
industrial rotating machines.
Okay.
A kind of predictive maintenance.
How many machines are there?
So I will be doing this experiment on rotating machines only from the industry, like pumps, motors. Not yet finalized the names, sir, but I'm working on it. And since I was working on in this field before also, so I wanted to implement this artificial intelligence aspect, wherein we need some experts in this or trained experts. We need to tell the faults. So my approach was to do it using artificial intelligence.
Okay. Okay, Shreya, that's good enough. So I understood your exact problem statement or where you want to work. So yes, this can be a definitely a diagnosis kind of thing wherein you require to collect you know, data from the rotating machines, right, and understand the how that particular data is behaving, right, and based on that you want to under you apply this AI, right, to
yes.
Control the rotating machines as such, right, industrial rotating machines. Here I will say ki, definitely your guide is best person to decide the final problem statement, but the PERT is already a one tool which help us to, you know, analyze this thing, right? So if you at all you are decided to use AI also and PERT also, it will be very crucial for you and your guide to decide how to do the combination of two different tools, right? Whether to create AI tool for PERT itself, or you have to use the PERT and AI both the tools simultaneously. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So that is another thing. But it's confirmed that yes, your problem statement definitely fall under the category of diagnosis. Okay. Yes. Anybody who thinks that their problem statement falls under hypothesis?
Hello.
Huh.
So I don't know whether I'm not sure about this, but my problem statement is on feature extraction with fuzzy classifier for tomatoes.
Come again?
Feature extraction. Feature extraction.
Hmm?
With fuzzy classifier.
Or fuzzy classifier.
With fuzzy classifier.
With.
Yeah. With fuzzy classifier for tomatoes. For tomatoes.
Oh,
it's an image processing based project.
Okay.
Yeah. So still on the initial stages. I mean.
And on which aspects you are working?
Sir, like defining the maturity of the tomatoes, like shape, size, all these things are considered. Like first we take the image of the tomato and then convert that RGB image into a YAB. And then you have to, there are certain physicality, extent, cross ratio, these things are being considered. And based on that, we'll find the maturity, like whether it is ripe, unripe, or whether it is partially ripe. Based on the size, we'll define it, whether it is small, big, or medium, and whether on the shape, whether it is deform, or whether it is well-defined. So all these three things will be like clubbed together and to a decision-making process, wherein they'll classify whether it belongs to class 1, class 2, and class 3. Class 1 is the higher one, better quality tomato and something that, yeah. So just on the initial stages, sir, I mean, not done much of things like
that. Right, right. Good. I understood this. So firstly, I congratulate you that you selected some, you know, problem which are directly associated with the society, right? And that going to benefit the society as such or farmer as such. That is a good thing.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So it's definitely a hypothesis kind of stuff, because wherein you want to, you know, judge something, maybe whether the tomato ripen or not, or it is at, you know, is it in category one is completely ripe, right?
Yeah.
Category
B,
halfly ripe, or category three is not at, you know, started
partially ripe.
And based on the different parameters, factors you give as a inputs to your classifier, right?
Yeah.
One of them could be image. Right. So based on processing the image and other factors, you can going to give a judgment that whether it is category 1, A, B or C type of tomatoes. OK,
yes, sir.
So that's good. So it's just like, you know, if at all baby is crying, then whether the baby is hungry or something bites baby or something else happened. Right. Giving that type of decision falls under this particular category. So, yes, your project will definitely come under the hypothesis kind of thing. Right. Sure.
OK, sir. Thank you. Yeah.
Sometimes it so happened that it also falls in other category, right?
Okay.
So
okay.
More we explore the statement and exact process of doing this work, right? If at all some data is available with you and there is so much of data available, and then you have to just feed that data to the fuzzy classifier and then decide, then it may falls under diagnose category, right?
Okay.
But if
okay.
you are starting collecting a data, right? It's beginning the collecting data, collecting images and so many things, then it becomes under the hypothesis kind of thing.
Okay.
Right?
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
So but at the first go, we can definitely say that it's on hypothesis thing, right?
Okay.
Anyone who thinks that their problem statement falls under the induction or deduction kind of thing? Anyone?
Hello. Good morning, sir.
Yeah, Pritha.
Actually, sir, I don't finalize the title yet, but I want to analyze the speech signal of a human being.
Okay.
Using some AI tools
mm-hmm.
That predicts the physical and mental health of the human being.
Okay.
That will help us to, if there is any change in the speech of the human being, if he go through some serious disease, like that thing.
Mm-hmm.
So it falls under this category or diagnostic.
Yes. Again, in the same condition, Shreya, Pritha, like if at all you have all the data is available with you, right, then it may comes under the diagnose thing, right?
Okay.
And look, we talked about the project about dye, the dye which is, you know, we have to increase the life of a dye as such, right? So in that, for that project also, if the complete database is available with him, and in terms of design and everything, and he just modifying a little one feature of that particular die, that may it make under induction and deduction, right?
Okay.
Right. But he started from collecting the data, analyzing it, and then it may fall under diagnose. In your case also, if at all you trying to judge people's mental condition based on how he is speaking, right? So there are two aspects. One is like you are collecting data, even you are identifying a technique or methodology that what parameter to be considered, right? It's voice texture or voice throw, the speed with which he is speaking or she is speaking. There are so many factors, right? And based on that factor, you started collecting the data, and then collecting the data, you are utilizing some tools to diagnose it, and then coming to the conclusion, then it all comes under the diagnosis thing, right?
Okay.
Or maybe a kind of hypothesis that you are predicting that he is well with well health or not, right? But
actually, sir, nowadays the online consultation is in process because of this COVID. Mm-hmm. So this thing is helping in that that manner also,
right?
While online consultation.
Yes, I got it. Telemedicine, right? Telecounseling for the health as such, right? So they, it will be definitely helpful. So if at all you have data available with you, and like if already somebody has done a research, they already collected data, and some of the factor you think that this is a factor they missed out when they did the research, and they should have considered, right? Suppose I will say ki already research has been done, but they forget that while people speak online, they speak differently. And when those people speak, you know, 1:1, they speak differently.
Yes.
Right? In our case also same thing happened. Whenever time comes for us to speak online, we little bit modify ourselves in terms of voice, texture, the way we are speaking, and so many things. Right? Forget about the online. Those who are into teaching profession, they know that when they are delivering a lecture in the classroom, they know speak differently, and when they are at home, they speak differently, right?
Yes.
So the condition in which people are talking also matters. And suppose if you have something, some project already available with you, wherein they have already diagnosed that how the people's health based on the different parameters, like the frequency of sound, the amplitude of the sound, and so many things, and based on that they already judge the health of person, but based on the factor that the condition in which he is speaking, then your project will be just addition or deduction of the feature into that existing project, right?
Yes.
So that time your project may become induction or reduction type of thing, right?
Okay.
But if you are collecting a data from a scratch, you are defining the process or the factors to be considered, then it will definitely fall under diagnosis hypothesis kind of thing. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Right. So this is how I think you should able to categorize your problem statement. I hope this particular discussion of 10-15 minutes will help you to decide that under which category your project is falling, and accordingly you will adopt the methodology, and you will try to define all the things related to your research work. So many times I ask people that in which area you are working. So broadly the statement comes in mechanical engineering, in electronics engineering, in civil engineering, in CS. So do you think that this type of categories are now remain? I am not asking you to give me the exact field, but what I think is like, we can't say something like, yes, we are exactly working in the mechanical engineering field, or we are working in the electronics engineering field, right? This is something which I am taking to make you educate ki how the scenario of research has changed now, right? For that, I have a next slide wherein I will suggest you to think about this, that in what area your research is going on. Broadly, you will say civil, electronics, mechanical, CS, applied sciences. But you must be using some sensors and controllers in your project, right? Is it possible? Even mechanical engineers can use sensors and controllers nowadays. Forget about mechanical, civil engineering people. Is there anyone from civil engineering in the group?
Yes, sir.
Okay, what's your name?
Arti Vagmare, sir.
Okay, anyone else?
Yes, sir.
Okay, what's your good name?
Soham Vavre.
So only two people from civil engineering?
I'm not from civil, sir. I'm from mechanical, but I'll be using sensors and controllers.
Okay, great. So what I meant to say that though you are working in the civil or mechanical engineering, you will be using this type of thing, right? Isn't it? Then you will be using algorithms. So presently we can consider sensors and controllers. Controllers are completely a part of electronics engineering, but still mechanical and civil engineering are using it, right? You will be using the algorithm, right? You will be using mathematical modeling to simulate something or to diagnose something, right? Which is completely part of mathematics. You will be using social aspects. There may be some ethical things related to your project, right? There may be some industrial aspects, right? Though I will quote a very good example of this particular aspect. Who is from civil engineering?
I'm from civil, sir.
What's your name?
Arti.
Arti, yesterday I come across a very good documentary wherein there is a need of identifying printers, 3D printers, which can construct buildings or which can do the construction in space.
Okay, sir.
Or on the other planets. Suppose human being reached to the Mars, right? Or on moon. They find need to construct building on moon, right? Mm-hmm. You can't take 1,000 labors, no? Like at Simba, at SIT, we are constructing 4, 5, 6 floor. And we have 1,000 labor working here. Can we take 1,000 labor to the Mars or moon to construct a building?
No, possible.
That, wo Nati ko contract de diya, chalo 1,000 logo ko leke ja. Nahi ho sakta hai.
No,
only 2 people can move there, right? Through a shuttle. So what about constructing something on moon or Mars? So you definitely required a robot or a printer kind of thing which will construct the thing on the space, in the space, right?
Yes.
Now the challenge is, like, if you think about 3D printers, 3D printers can definitely print efficiently on Earth, right? Because there is gravity associated with the 3D printers. The material coming out of the nozzle are get down on the platform through gravity. Because material get pulled down below and it get laid down on the platform or the plate on which we are printing the material, isn't it? But think about the space where there is a no gravity, a complete vacuum, the material will not come out of the nozzle only, isn't it? So this will be a technical difficulty, but when it comes for a civil engineering to think of, some mechanism which will help them to construct the thing in the space or in zero gravity, there is a complete collaboration of, industrial aspect, a mechanical and civil engineering, isn't it?
Yes.
Wherein complete machines will come in picture for the civil engineering, right?
Yes.
So again, you won't be, if at all you are working on such a machine which will construct something in the space, you won't be able to say that you are working in civil engineering thing, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So that's what I'm trying to make you understand, that nowadays there won't be any specific field as such remain, right? It's all integrated, all collaboration happen. And most effective is this artificial intelligence and machine learning. This particular technique or tool has penetrated every aspect of our life, right? Not only CS, but ENTC, mechanical, civil, food processing, anything you consider. The medical science, diagnosis, anything, right? So the efficient tool can be used everywhere, right? It is going to lead the world in future. So maybe somebody work in mechanical engineering, but efficiently using this AI ML. So he won't say that I have worked in the mechanical engineering. It's integrated, right? So the scenario, the strategies and the statement need to be revised or rethink before we declare that, yes, we work in this so-and-so area. Right. So I required one JRF now for my sponsor project, and we are working on vibrations, but we are going to analyze that vibration using AIML. Right. So when I want my JRF with me, I am thinking that he or she should be in, having experience in AIML, because I want to implement that tool, use that tool for vibration purpose. Right. So when I put advertisement or website that I have required JRF, right? I have to exactly mention that I want someone who has got experience or who know the concept of AIML, right? But if you are a candidate, you are applying for that particular post, and you are for mechanical, from mechanical engineering, and if you just say, okay, sir, can I join you as a JRF? If I ask you in which discipline you are, you say mechanical engineering. So then I will say, no, I want someone who has got experience in AIML. And then probably you will say that, no, sir, I have already done projects in this area. I have implemented this tool for various purposes in mechanical engineering. So that time I can think of, taking you as a JRF, right? But you have to be very specific while mentioning your specialization, your project area, your research area, right? Just don't blindly or blankly say that you are working into mechanical, electronics or civil engineering as such, isn't it? So this scenario has changed. I just wanted you to, know these things, that how the present research scenario has changed. Okay. Now, you have your problem statement ready with you, right? And you are aware about your research problem now. Most of you have submitted it during semester. But have you ever thought about this thing, that whatever your research you are going to do, right, has got so many things associated with it, right? So you think that whether you have take care of these things, or are you aware about this thing that you are going to address all these things during 4 years of time, right? First thing, are you going to provide that solution to the problem, right? Whatever the problem you try to address, is your research at the end of the 4 years going to provide a complete solution? Are you coming up with the exact product or final product which will be delivering solution to the problem you address? Think about this. Second thing, is your research is based upon the observation, experience or empirical evidences? If at all you think that while doing the literature review, if you think that your research has kept most importance how previously work is being done in this area. Look, I will definitely tell you that 80% of you will be working upon the project which are already being done somewhere in some other way, right? Jo research scholar bolega ki maine jab search kiya sir mere research topic ke upar, to I got 100 papers, 150 papers in the same area. तो मैं उसे बोलूंगा कि तुम रिसर्च मत करो. जिस एरिया में ऑलरेडी 200-300 पेपर मिल चुके हैं, तुम उसमें क्या रिसर्च करोगे और, राइट? सो थिंक अबाउट दिस. जिस जो बोलेगा सर मुझे कुछ मिला ही नहीं है, मैंने इतना सर्च किया, गूगल में सर्च किया, साइंस डायरेक्ट पे सर्च किया, कितने डेटाबेसेस ढूंढे लेकिन कुछ नहीं मिला, तो आई विल से इट्स अ परफेक्ट प्रॉब्लम स्टेटमेंट टू रिसर्च अपॉन, राइट? सो when you are starting research, when you are doing literature review, and if you think that your problem statement is completely based on the effectiveness of your problem statement is completely based upon the study which has already been done previously, so you have to accordingly do the literature review. You have to see that you have thorough or got the 100% knowledge about the whatever happened so far, right? If at all your research is based upon the observation made earlier or whatever the evidences are available in the present scenario, right? Remember this. Research demands accurate observation and description. Very important, right? Observation hai, to observation wo accurate hone chahiye. In case of the speech project, right, I mentioned that you can even consider the state in which that person is speaking, right? Many times persons are not physically well, but if at all he is a CEO of company and he has to address thousands of people, right, then he has to be a strong voice. From that particular speech you can't diagnose that he is ill or having some physical problem as such, right? Or in a way that situation may arise when the person is exactly giving the test for the speech recognition, right? If he is a person of high repute and even if he come to the doctor to give his voice texture to understand whether he is ill or not, he may not speak in the same way he is speaking at home, right? So your observation are very important when you are going to diagnose anything. Your description is very important, right? So look, these all are the characteristics of the research you should remember while pursuing your problem statement. Next is, research involves gathering new data from primary source or using existing data for a new purpose. Very clear, right? Data collection is very important. Whatsoever may be, it kam jada hai data hai, jada data hai, kitna bhi rahe, lekin iska collection, many times that I will share my, look, as I am giving you introduction to the research, I am here to share my experiences with you. That will help you to properly plan your research, right? Because on this each topic, like literature review, design of research, and the formulation of the problem, and thesis writing, publication of paper, on all this topic, there will be a separate speaker who are going to give you dedicated speech on that topic, and which will give insights about that particular topic thoroughly, right? So you are going to get that. But here I am giving you overall idea about research area. So that's why I am briefly sharing my experiences with you, right? So while gathering the data, do it half-heartedly. Like, you know, you should collect almost 100% data available for that particular research work. Should not miss out the single parameter or single data available in the market or any of the organization. Otherwise, it may happen that after doing a work for 2-3 years and you suddenly come across some data which was collected by some researcher, and by mistake you ignore that while collecting the data, and it many times is going to impact mostly on the findings. So gathering the accurate data is very important. Research activities are characterized by carefully designed procedure. These particular characteristics oriented towards research design. Research design is very important topic which clearly defines how you should carry out your research in 4 years, beginning with the problem statement to the thesis writing till facing the defense of your project. So that all comes under the research design. Again, it's a separate topic. A speaker or a faculty going to speak on this, how to design your research. Research requires expertise, that is skill necessary to carry out investigation, search, etc. Do you think that whatever the topic you selected, you are not expertise into it? Or it's completely altogether different? If it is so, then try to bring in that skill sets into you. A proper reading, thorough reading of that particular area can make you perfect, right? Otherwise, it so happens that yes, you are completely new in some field. Your guide is already working from 3-4 years in that field. He knows thoroughly, but you are something new. And आपने बोला सर आप जो project करेंगे हम लोग करेंगे उसको. ठीक है, सर ने एक topic दे दिया, आप शुरू हो गए काम करने के लिए. But you can only work efficiently if you also have thorough knowledge of that particular topic. And for that, you have to gain that expertise through literature review or through reading or to accessing the similar case studies, right? So that skill sets are very, very important to carry out the investigation. Research is objective and logical, right? आपके प्रॉब्लम स्टेटमेंट में अगर आपको आज ही लग रहा है कि इसमें कुछ लॉजिक नहीं है यार, कुछ तो भी एट रैंडम लग रहा है मुझे ये टॉपिक, राइट, तो मत करो उसको, राइट? यू कैन थिंक ट्वाइस, थ्राइस, 10 times बिफोर फाइनलाइजिंग योर टॉपिक, बिकॉज समवेयर यू क्लिक, यस इट्स लॉजिकल, इट्स वेरी वेल पॉसिबल टू डू रिसर्च इन दिस एरिया, देर विल बी वेरी हाई इम्पैक्ट ऑफ डूइंग रिसर्च इन टू दैट एरिया. It's very well associated with the society. So many things comes into your mind the moment you read out your own problem statement, right? Or you decide your problem statement. But suddenly some new comes in front of you from your guide or from your colleague that do research into this area. And if you don't find that there is not logical to do that, don't go for that research project, right? The moment you read the problem statement, that 3-4 objective of that research should be come in front of you. Yes, yes, yeah, hoga isme. Then only go for that particular project. Research involves the quest for answers to unsolved problems, right? Urge chahiye aapme, yes, I am going to address this problem. While defining the objective, you should clearly mention that what is not it solved, and that is what I am going to resolve now under my research. So that is one of the characteristics. Research require courage. Yes, very important that you already acquired the moment you were enrolled for the PhD. I hope you are decided. You already decided in mind that what is going to happen. Very first slide I shown you the figure, the slide figure, right? Always remember that figure throughout your PhD program. That's why I mentioned that research required courage. Research is also characterized by patience and unhurried activities. अनहरीड एक्टिविटीज मैंने कहा ना कि जब आपको लगे कि अरे मेरे में बहुत ज़्यादा पेशेंस डेवलप हो गया है, मैं लोगों को अच्छे से सुनने लगा हूँ, मैं उनकी बातें जानने लगा हूँ, और जब वो चाहे वही मैं उनको सॉल्यूशन बता रहा हूँ, राइट, तब समझ लेना तुम्हारा पीएचडी जो है वो खत्म होने को आया है. दैट पेशेंस एंड दैट अनहरीड एक्टिविटीज विल ऑटोमेटिकली डेवलप इन टू यू, राइट, दैट कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स यू विल अचीव ऑटोमेटिकली. रिसर्च इज केयरफुली रिकॉर्डेड एंड रिपोर्टेड, वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. 10 साल के बाद भी अगर आपका रिपोर्ट थीसिस कोई देखे तो उसको समझ में आना चाहिए कि आपने क्या किया है, व्हाट एग्जैक्टली यू आइडेंटिफाइड, व्हाट एग्जैक्टली यू आर रिसर्च अपॉन, राइट. सो थीसिस राइटिंग वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट आस्पेक्ट एज दैट ऑफ द प्रॉब्लम सिलेक्शन. सो देर विल बी अ सेपरेट सेशन ऑन दिस ऑल्सो, दैट हाउ टू राइट थीसिस. आई थिंक डॉक्टर पोहेकर हैज ऑलरेडी गिवन यू इनसाइट अपॉन थीसिस राइटिंग, राइट. So try to remember and try to implement that thing throughout your project, right? The accuracy of recording and reporting is not only for the final thesis. It comes in all stages of your research work. I will explain you during this, like literature review is one of the thing after this problem statement definition, right? So during that reported recording and reporting is absolutely required, right? So I hope you understood this all characteristics of research, and some of these are you will remember by now only, and try to reproduce whenever required. Okay. Now for the next slides, like when we are going to discuss upon various aspect of this, I want any problem statement is there. So I will pick up the whatever problems given by here only, right? So a blockchain implemented vending machine for regulating subsidized food distribution. This I am selecting for CS, isn't it? CS mein hai na aapka kaam?
Yes sir.
Okay. AI for machine computing part analysis. Shall I consider this for mechanical? The one who is working in this?
So I'm from electronics.
ENTC?
Sir, I'm from electronics.
Okay.
Yes.
Why I'm putting it under that field? Because you will have that mind orientation while doing projects that yes, I am from this field. So automatically that touch come to that problem, research problem or research work. Feature extraction, it will comes under the CS only?
No, I'm from...
You are from which field? Electronics?
No, I'm from electronics and telecommunication. Electronics, okay. And telecommunication. EXTC.
Okay, got it. New ways to generate renewable energy? He must be working in mechanical, right? Hello. I don't think it's time for lunch or sleep. Who has given this problem statement? Ashwin?
Hello sir.
Ha.
This is not mine.
Okay, it's not your. Okay, fine. But anyway, I think it's from mechanical engineering, suppose, right? The person,
yeah,
who
maybe I don't know.
Sir, it's
Yes?
Sir, I am Ambarish. It's my statement.
Okay, Ambarish. You are from mechanical?
Sir, I cannot listen.
Are you from mechanical engineering? Hello?
Sir, just a minute.
Are you from mechanical engineering? Ambarish?
No, sir.
Computer. Okay, fine. Then we won't take it for mechanical then. Anyone? Achha, civil engineering, aapne kya kaha tha problem statement? What's your problem statement?
Hello, sir. I have not given any problem statement. Tentatively, I have decided optimization of a cantilever wall.
Cantilever?
Wall.
Come again?
Wall,
sir. Wall?
Wall, retaining wall.
Retaining wall.
Yes, sir.
I wrote it properly.
Yes, sir.
Anyone from mechanical can share the problem with me?
Sir, development of high order accurate method for structural related.
High order?
Accurate method for unstructured machines.
Accurate?
Method.
Methods? For?
For the simulation of unstructured mesh fluid flows.
Unstructured mesh?
Fluid flows.
Okay. Anyone found applied sciences? You have to come closer to mic because there is a echo sound coming in. Anyone else who can share the statement? Some humming sound or noise is coming in through your mic. Anyone would like to share the statement from applied sciences? Anyone is there from applied science or no?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Please share.
Innovative new innovative material for treating wastewater.
This way?
New innovative methods to treat wastewater.
Wastewater, no? Can you see it on slide? Can you read it?
No, sir. Right now, I'm not able to see.
You don't have any screen in front of you?
Mobile? Yeah, I have, but it is not updatable.
No, I'm sharing my screen. My slide is visible to everyone, right?
Yeah, I can see slide, but...
It is not visible, sir, right now.
Pardon?
It is not visible.
No.
Now it is visible, yes.
Yes, sir. Now I can see. Yeah.
Okay. So, innovative material for treatment of wastewater, right?
Yeah, materials, yes, please.
Okay. It should be a new innovative or it should be only innovative?
Right.
It should be innovative only, right?
Yeah.
Or you want that specific word, new innovative?
No. It's not like this. Because new innovative will be always
right. New, right?
Yeah.
That's why. Fine. So we are considering these four statements throughout our discussion in the next slides. Okay. So for mechanical engineering, it's a development of high order accurate method for simulation of unstructured mesh in fluid flow. Okay. For ENTC AI on edge computing device for PERT analysis of industrial rotating machine. civil optimization of cantilever retaining wall, CSIT blockchain implemented vending machine for regulating subsidized food distribution, and applied science innovative material for treatment of wastewater. Great. So all of you just remember all these problem statement, because when in the next slide when I will be quoting some examples to make you understand the content given on the slide, I may be quote this statement. I may try to explain you in terms of this particular project so that it will be understandable to you, right? So everyone can maybe take a print shot or keep this statement ready with them to refer in the next presentation. Right? So, yes?
So for PC, AI on computing device, AI on edge computing for fault tenant.
For?
Completely decided statement, but over this, not, it is fault fault.
I could not hear you. Your voice was breaking.
It is fault analysis.
Where should I put the word fault?
Instead of fault, it is fault.
Oh, is it?
Yeah. Thank you.
So earlier it was not visible. That's why I discussed like while discussing.
I thought PERT is some different word.
Huh, it's a technique, it's a tool for analysis.
Then I said it was by mistake. Yes.
No. PERT is a completely different technique in mechanical engineering, especially in operation research, right? We use this tool PERT. PERT, okay.
Yes, sir.
Hello, sir.
Huh?
Are you going to share this presentation after this session?
Yes, it's yours only, right? Okay. Definitely available. Even this recording is available. This complete video recording is available. So, if you request Satish Kumar, sir, then he will provide that complete video to you. You can listen after some times also, or maybe tomorrow, whenever you want. Okay. So you can again listen, go through this discussion by viewing the video again. Yeah. Right. So you finalize your this thing problem statement now. Now we will try to understand like those who have given the problem statement is okay. This is available with you us, and those who has not given, they can keep their problem statement ready with them and think about that particular problem statement, whether their problem statement is fulfilling the next slide criteria or not. Okay. So when it comes that if you want to decide that whether your project or research going to fulfill something or at the end, so you can think on this line, right? Is your purpose is clearly defined or not? Right, whatever problem statement you defined, whether that purpose, what you want to address, is clearly defined or not, you have to ensure that. Right? Look, each time I am giving you some keywords in my slide. So here the word I have given you is have you thought about this? So you can ask this question yourself so that you will able to write the characteristics of the research in your examination. Now here I have given you the word ensure, right? That will help you to decide that criteria of the good research. You can answer this particular topic by using the term ensure with respect to your own problem statement. Okay. Is the purpose of your problem statement is clearly defined, or purpose of your research is clearly defined in the problem statement? Ensure that. Have you detailed out the research process? That will come in the stage where you are going to design your research, right? That is very, very crucial stage. You have to sit with your guide and come properly define how you are going to do your research throughout your 4 years, right? It's kind of a flow chart or kind of architect of your project work. That is what research design, whether truly planned or not. is there any high ethical standard applied to your research project? If yes, then if at all it is addressed or not. Limitation frankly revealed. मेरे प्रोजेक्ट में ये हो सकता है, ये नहीं हो सकता है, ये क्लियर होना चाहिए, राइट? मेनी टाइम्स इट सो हैपन दैट आई विल कोट अ एग्जांपल. सपोज समबडी इज वर्किंग अपॉन द एआई प्रिंसिपल, राइट? क्या था वो? एआई ऑन एज कंप्यूटिंग डिवाइसेस फॉर फाइनल एनालिसिस ऑफ इंडस्ट्रियल रोटेटिंग मशीन, राइट? So here she is going to apply some algorithm, isn't it? आप कोई algorithm use करोगे ना, AI algorithm?
Yes, yes, I will be using an algorithm using. So basically, I will be taking the data from the vibration sensor, and that data will be analyzed using an FFT spectrum. Based Great. On the FFTs, that algorithm I'll be using.
Great. So any of the algorithm you name?
So no, I don't know the names of the algorithm, but
doesn't matter.
The FFT spectrum.
Okay, so there may be various algorithms available, right, which can be applied to this particular method for particular problem, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So you will be selecting any one out of it, isn't it?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Or you thought of using 2-3 algorithm and then compare the result of 2 algorithm and say ki which is the best one?
Yes, sir. Actually, I'll be using the FFT spectrum to analyze the data.
Okay.
So based on that, I will be preparing my algorithm, or how am I going to go about it?
Understood. What I am trying to tell you all people here is, like, look, there are chances that suppose you take example of hers, that she is going to utilize one algorithm and she is going to find out the output of that algorithm for this particular task. Now there are chances that there are 2-3-4 algorithms available which can concluded as a equally efficient to give result in so and so area, right? And it's like ki, if at all there are 2-3 algorithms which are available, which are giving the same result, then it becomes difficult to select any one of the algorithm there. Because at the end of your project, when you are facing the defense, your examiner may ask you, why you have selected this algorithm, why not that algorithm also, why you have not selected algorithm B? Algorithm B is also equally competent to give you results in this area. So there should be a proper justification ready with you that why you have used that particular algorithm to carry out research. If at all you have frankly revealed that no, there are out of 4-5 algorithms, this A algorithm is the best. I can give you that from our literature review that many of the researchers has clearly mentioned that A algorithm is giving the exact value or output for this type of problem. So why to go for using B algorithm or C algorithm or D algorithm? So that's why I use A algorithm, right? And that's what we call as the frankly revealing the what I say, limitations. You should able to reveal ki nahi ye hai mera project mein yahi ho sakta hai, right? Other example I will quote. Suppose she is using any one AI algorithm here, and there are 2 algorithms which are equally competent to give output for this particular problem. But the difficulty is each algorithm is taking so much of time, right? And another example will take another time to complete that particular task. Then working on both the algorithm, getting the result out of the comparing it and showing that out of these 2, this one is exactly working, giving the result, will take 5-6 years to complete that task. So you should, in the beginning only, you are clearly referring that I am going to use this particular algorithm. That will ensure the examiner that yes, this person has beforehand, in the beginning of the project only, decided that he is going to use this algorithm. So nowhere I can ask the researcher or scholar a question that why you have not used the other algorithm. So if you revealed your limitations frankly in the beginning of the project, that will help you to defend yourself at the end of the project. Especially in case of this mechanical engineering and simulation kind of thing, it happens. We have to select the mesh size. And many times, depending upon the complexity of design, right, if you decide the mesh size, that simulation takes almost 12 hours, 18 hours, 24 hours, sometimes 2 to 3 days to simulate the thing, design, right? So somehow the designer has to come down to the mesh size, right? And suddenly in the examination at the end, examiner asks, why you are not selected this particular mesh set, right? So if at all you don't have any computing facility available to simulate that particular mesh size design, then you should beforehand only frankly reveal that thing into your project, right? That this is not going to happen, that's why I am going to select this particular mesh size. So in short, you should frankly reveal your limitations. Adequate analysis of decision makers needs, right? For many times you will find that you will require a decision or suggestion from the expert, right? But there are thousands of people you will get that they will suggest something for your project. Arey, aisa nahi waisa karo, aisa nahi waisa karo, ye aisa karke dekho, waisa karke dekho, right? But you have to decide ki which decision, which suggestion is accurately matching with your requirement, and accordingly analyze it and try to implement it. Finding presented unambiguously. Whatever findings comes out of your research work should be presented unambiguously, right? I will quote example. We are going to we saw the example of this. Blockchain implemented vending machine for regulating the subsidized foods distribution. इनके प्रोजेक्ट के इनके रिसर्च वर्क का जब फाइंडिंग्स आएंगे तो वो क्लियरली अनएम्बिग्यूस होना चाहिए. शी शुड एबल टू क्लियरली से दैट माय वेंडिंग मशीन इज गोइंग टू गेट इंप्लीमेंटेड इन दिस पर्टिकुलर एरिया विच विल बी मोस्ट बेनिफिशियल. उसमें अगर उन्होंने ब्रैकेट में लिखा कि प्रोवाइडेड पीपल शुड ईट ट्वाइस डेली, तो वो पूरा उस रिसर्च के आउटपुट का मजा निकल गया, राइट? या उन्होंने लिखा कि वेंडिंग मशीन विल बी इफिशियंटली यूटिलाइज इफ पीपल विल ईट 4 times a day, कंडीशनल, राइट? विच समटाइम्स मे नॉट पॉसिबल और मे नॉट बी अप्लीकेबल टू द पीपल इन दैट रीजन, राइट? सो समथिंग, दो शी हैज आइडेंटिफाइड समथिंग, बट इट इज बेस्ड ऑन सम कंडीशन which may not be able to implement also. So आपके जो findings है वो unambiguous होने चाहिए, right? It should be presented in a correct manner कि नहीं, this is the scenario in that demography or geographic location, and that's why these particular findings are accurately applicable to their people, not with certain condition which is not at all possible in that particular region, isn't it? So your result should be presented unambiguously. Conclusion justified, very important. Most of the time, people concluded, you know, without doing any confirmatory experiment. In case of mechanical engineering or civil or electronics, wherein actual projects or there are physical projects, which are physical machines, things available, which are going to operate based on the research done by you, should able to function what you have concluded, right? And many times it was requirement of the research work that whatever your findings are there, you have to actually implement that particular project, again collect the result when it is actually working, and then showing that whatever the data are there based on the working functioning of that project is matching with the result you concluded during the project research. That is we call as a confirmatory experimentation in mechanical engineering, right? अगर आपने कोई IC engine के पिस्टन के ऊपर एक एडिशनल रिंग फिक्स कर दी एंड यू इन योर रिसर्च यू आर मेंशनिंग दैट ड्यू टू दिस मॉडिफिकेशन इन द पिस्टन राइट your engine is giving you average of 25 kilometers per liter but you have to prove it you have to implement that engine in any car you have to run that car you have to run it by putting some fuel into it get the result and you have to clearly show that yes it is giving a 25 kilometers average per liter right that we called as the results are justified confirmed isn't it so criteria of the good research is your conclusion should be justified. Researcher experience should get reflected in the research work. Right? वाइवा के टाइम पे ऐसा नहीं होना चाहिए कि हाँ मैंने तो ऐसा कहा मेरे रिसर्च तो ऐसा ऐसा कह रहा है कि दिस इज गोइंग टू हैपन हैव यू एक्सपीरियंस इन केस ऑफ स्पीच रिकग्निशन आपने कंफर्म कर दिया कि अगर कोई आदमी बात करते करते ऐसा करता है तो ही इज नॉट वेल राइट बट इट मे नॉट बी ट्रू फॉर ऑल पीपल राइट सम पीपल मे हैव दैट हैबिट ओनली राइट बट वॉट एवर दैट रिसर्च हैज गॉट द एक्सपीरियंस व्हाइल इंटरेक्टिंग विद द पीपल दैट एक्सपीरियंस ओनली शुड रिफ्लेक्टेड इन द रिसर्च आउटपुट नॉट समथिंग विच इज कंप्लीटली थियोरेटिकल राइट नहीं तो वो बोलेंगे नहीं नहीं मेरा तो रिसर्च के आउटपुट बोलता है कि व्हेनेवर देयर इज सम अदर नॉइज कमिंग व्हाइल स्पीकिंग दैट मीन दैट पर्सन इज इल राइट सो दैट मे नॉट जस्टिफाइड सम टाइम एट द एंड ऑफ द रिसर्च सो एक्सपीरियंस द रिसर्चर्स एक्सपीरियंस शुड बी रिफ्लेक्टेड इन इट्स और हर प्रोजेक्ट वर्क दैट ऑल दिस पॉइंट्स देन ओनली वी कॉल दैट इज अ गुड रिसर्च वर्क ओके सो आई होप ऑल दिस थिंग्स आर क्लियर टू यू So at the end of the research, your research should be a systematic research. It should be logical, right? There should be a certain logic working behind that findings. It should be empirical. It should be replicable. It should be creative, right? And use of a multiple method, right? In all condition, it should be applicable, right? So these are the findings for the good research. So I think today we will stop here. There are so many things coming up that we require to understand the scope of the research and the problem faced during research. And then I am also going to express myself a little bit on how to go about literature review, how to design your research, you know, and in terms of a little bit in terms of the how to go about the publication, right? So that will give you insight of complete about introduction to the research thing, right? Research methodology. So I try to you know cover it all and try to justify whatever my experience, try to share my experience with you, and through that I will try to teach you what do you mean by research design. So today I think it's a time to break now because it's almost 12:20. And you are about to take your lunch and then there is a next session ready for you. So far is there any query or any question? So we can take them for next 5-10 minutes and then we can break here for today. And maybe next Friday I will cover remaining part of this particular topic and try to explain everything to you. Okay. But presently for next 5-10 minutes, I can definitely take few questions from you so that whatever the topic covered so far can be thoroughly understood. Okay. So anybody has any query, any questions?
So how to get the access coordinate meeting?
Access to the
recording meeting, sir.
Your internet connection is little bit, I think, disturbing. So, can you come again?
So, how to get access to the recording meeting?
To?
recordings of this meeting. Now this lecture,
Okay. Now these recordings are already available in Teams. We are presently working Teams, right? So just after this session, that recording is already available in Teams. Okay, you can either download it. If at all you do not have access of downloading this presentation or this recording, then you can definitely write to Dr. Satish. He will provide that recording to you. Okay. Just to avoid the misuse of the recording, we have not given rights to the students to download this recording directly from the Teams. You have to request maybe a coordinator or technical person like system administrator to give this recording to you. In that case, if at all this recording get misused by someone, then that person who has demanded recording is completely responsible. So there is no worry in sharing this recording with you. You can definitely get this recording from either Dr. Satish Kumar or from Mr. Rajesh Tripathi, who is a system administrator at SIT. Okay.